Quickly, let me acknowledge that we also have with us our Canadian members and guests. We have the Government of Saskatchewan representatives. We have Government of New Brunswick representatives, as well as a lot of our industry members. And thank you very much for being here with us, our Indian Board of Directors, my ICBC team. And we all together join in welcoming Mr. P. Harish, Mr. Rashesh Shah, and of course, Anita George will be joining us in precisely 3 minutes, if I'm not mistaken. So, Mr. Harish, welcome. Mr. Harish is the Additional Secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs for Economic Affairs and Economic Diplomacy. Mr. Harish was earlier Consul General in Houston, and thereafter, his last posting was as Ambassador to Vietnam. I think held many challenging positions, but I think this is one of the most challenging times. So we won't debate on that as to which will be his most challenging assignment after this. Sarish, I would also like to say that, you know, I've met him probably maybe 10 months or so back. And along with being a fabulous officer, he has been a thorough gentleman. I've enjoyed whatever interactions we've had with you, Mr. Harish. And thank you and welcome. Welcome to our webinar, to the ICBC webinar. I'm going to come back to you with the questions. Let me quickly introduce Mr. Rashesh Shah. Mr. Rashesh Shah is the chairman and co-founder of Edelweiss Group. As he has said, Edelweiss sounds international, but is very much an Indian group. And it is one of the, I think, one of the biggest financial service organizations in India today. It has a very big name. But I just want to say that he's a financier with an equally big heart. And we'll come back to you later, Rashesh, with what you have been doing on EdGive, your project in the recent times, and helping migrants and others. So, you know, we are thank you, Rashesh, for joining us. And also, he's been past president of FICCI. Immediate past president, or I think a year back, Rashesh. I think it was in that role that I met Rashesh first. And since then, we have kept closely in touch. We have a lot of things in common. One of them, I won't say a lot of things, but one thing definitely in common, which is Ahmedabad and Gujarat, which is very close to my heart. Welcome, Rashesh. I think Anita has been on a board meeting call with Canada. So while we wait for her, and probably Mr. Harish, I'll interrupt you even when you start for a quick introduction of Anita. But instead of, you know, waiting for her right now, I'd really like to start it off because I'm looking forward to a very interesting discussion with all of you here. Mr. Harish, you know, just want to say that you have always been, ever since that we have met and we've dragged you into this whole Canada-India relationship, and we've got you on a lot of our forums and a lot of our talks. So, you know, if you can tell us that in this context of the India-Canada bilateral engagement, what are the government, you know, measures that you have been doing to, I would say, not to attract, but to, you know, keep the confidence of the Canadian investor on the FDIs, the, you know, the FPIs? What have you been, what are you planning to do to keep this, to keep their confidence and to, you know, see that they remain in India, you know, with the financial investment? So over to you, Mr. Harish.
Thank you. Thank you, Nadraji, for your kind introduction. I want to thank the Indo-Canadian Business Chamber for inviting me and other colleagues who are here today as speakers. You know, you're one of the very active chambers in India promoting closer economic engagement between India and Canada, and I want to convey my appreciation and thank you for your effort. As India, we attach a very high priority to our strategic partnership and our economic engagement with Canada. Canada is a very key partner for us in our economic trajectory and in our infrastructure development. I think our economic partnership has been mutually beneficial. And we see Canada as an important partner in our effort to ensure food security for our people. And over the years, we have had a very close engagement with Canada in this sector. I think if you look at the current situation, of course, we are in the middle of a lockdown. The government is committed to save lives, to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic. The Prime Minister has repeatedly emphasized that it is very important to save lives and equally important to save livelihoods. And this is the focus as we proceed in tackling the pandemic in the period ahead. I must say that when we look at the whole issue, the government is very, very conscious that as we look at various strategies for exiting from the current period of lockdown and allowing certain activities to proceed from the from this week, from the 20th or so, I think a focus is on getting the economic engine in a graded manner back to function fully. The government is also very conscious to continue to make India a place which is very easy to do business in, and also to keep the attractiveness of India as a destination. What the current pandemic reveals is a desire of many countries globally, many companies globally, to ensure that they should de-risk their whole value chains. And in this, our effort is to position India as an attractive destination for FDI coming in as countries seek to de-risk their value chains so that they are not overtly dependent on one particular jurisdiction or the other. It's also an occasion for the trading community and countries' trading baskets to ensure that they're not overtly dependent for one particular set of goods on a country. So it's also a de-risking process that we will see going forward. And I can say that as far as we are concerned, the government, for example, in key sectors, increasingly, I think we would want that the whole value chain be in India. And one such is, of course, pharmaceuticals. The government has already announced 10,000 crores for shifting the entire manufacturing value chain for pharmaceuticals within India, including to boost domestic production of active pharmaceutical ingredients, the APIs. And we will create production-linked incentives for promotion of domestic manufacturing of critical drug intermediates and APIs within the country. We believe this is going to be an important step in strengthening our domestic pharma base. Of course, you're also aware of various other incentives for mobile and electronics manufacturing, including production-linked incentives for mobile electronic segments and components, capital subsidy for electronics manufacturing and electronics manufacturing clusters. May I welcome Ms. Anita George, and I'd love you to give an introduction of her.
Yeah, so when we started, Anita, I requested Mr. Harish that I might have to interrupt his address to quickly welcome you. And I would really like, so Anita George, for this is, you know, we have a Canadian audience as well as our Indian audience. And Anita, welcome here. Thank you for being with us. Anita is the Executive Vice President of CDPQ Growth Markets. You know, she has been very active in the Indian market, and we will get back to her with a few more questions later. But for the time being, Mr. Harish, please do continue.
Thank you.
And we'll come back to Anita with some questions.
Thank you.
You know, as far as Canada is concerned, for us, our bilateral trade with Canada was slightly over 10 billion Canadian dollars last year. And it's an important trade basket for us. Canada is an important trade partner, and we see an increase in both goods and services. For example, last year, our trade in services was roughly over 4 billion Canadian dollars. And this is also something which we see increasing. In terms of our investments, I think Canadian investments through FDI route are roughly about around slightly less than 3 billion Canadian dollars. However, the FPI route for investments from Canadian pension funds and other funds has been significant. And total to anywhere between 50 or 55 billion Canadian dollars. Now, FPI is very important, and for us, we look at investments in brownfield sectors as significant, because they enable local developers who are holding brownfield assets to be able to reinvest in other greenfield. So from our point of view, it's an important thing, and we want to encourage and further make it easier. I think the in the budget, of course, you are aware of the elimination of the dividend distribution tax. We have also, our finance ministry has announced a national infrastructure pipeline of 103 trillion rupees. This was launched late last year, and the budget had provisions to catalyze funding for this national infrastructure pipeline across various sectors. So from our point of view, I think giving tax exemption for sovereign wealth funds, for foreign pension funds, was an important initiative. We look at the importance of increasing the component of long-term sticky foreign funds as part of the overall assets under management of foreign portfolio investors in the country. I believe it's roughly slightly over a quarter of the as things stand. And of course, the assets under management of foreign portfolio investors is a fifth of the total market cap of Indian equity. So in this, I think the efforts from our side is to continue to position India as an important destination for FDI in various sectors. We can discuss the sectors later on as we move. It's also important for us to position India as an important destination for portfolio investors who want to invest in the country. I think the government in the period ahead would be undertaking significant reforms to make it further easier for investors in the country. So both the DPIIT and Invest India, our focus is to closely engage with Canadian investors who want to come here. There are a number of sectors. I'll be very happy to talk about some of the sectors of interest as far as we are concerned and why we believe Canadian investors in these sectors should come. We believe there is a close economic fit, and we believe that these are the areas which have a significant potential in India and which Canadian investors can come not only with capital, but more importantly with technology and with experience in these sectors. And that would be highly relevant as far as we are concerned. I'll stop at this, and we can go into the sectors and various other areas later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Harish. We'll come back to you. So, you know what he said, that here I have with me Rashesh Shah and Anita George. Both words apply very well to them. One is long-term and one is partnerships. So they have been a very successful partnership between CDPQ and Edelweiss Group. I'm going to ask Rashesh Shah, who is heads one of the, you know, very important financial services organization in India with the Edelweiss Group, to Rashesh, what are you seeing at this time, you know, because this is such a challenging time, and what do you see, that what are the problems that financial institutions are facing at this time, and what is this environment? What would you, you know, how would you describe it, and how would you think that financial institutions are coping at this time?
Yeah, I think as we were saying earlier, this is an unprecedented kind of an event. But before we go there, I want to thank you at BC and all of you for this opportunity to interact with so many, such an esteemed audience. So thanks for this opportunity. It is always a pleasure to talk about and also understand from all the others, my fellow panelists, as well as from all the people in the audience, on how things are evolving in the world, because this is such an unprecedented event that we are all grappling with it. I think for India, obviously, like every other country in the world, this is a crisis. I don't think there is any gainsaying in that. It's a healthcare humanitarian crisis on one side, but slowly and steadily, it will also be an economic crisis, because all the rules of the game are getting changed, whether it's credit markets, whether it's equity markets, whether it's commodity markets. Who would have thought that the price of oil could be below zero? And in the last few days, we have seen that also, which obviously, in a way, is very good for India. I think India is one of the large importers of oil. So I think the only good thing out of this crisis, as far as India is concerned, is price of oil and price of capital will both come down. And India is an importer of capital, and India is an importer of oil, and the cost of both of them will come down, because interest rates are also going below zero, and now we are seeing oil price going below zero. So it will be great for India to consume oil and hopefully also get paid for that in the near future. But having said that, I think obviously our economy over the last few years had been slowing down. We had the bank NPA, you know, huge NPAs in the bank because of over investment 8-10 years ago. And the cleanup of that was going on. In fact, the partnership that Datawise has along with CBQ is one of the key ones is in the area of distressed assets and asset reconstruction company. And about 4 years ago, we started this partnership to help Indian banks convert this NPAs into productive assets. And we have had a fairly good track record on that last 4 or 5 years. We have helped turn around a lot of companies. We have helped a lot of NPAs to be restructured. But because of this, Indian economy was already slowing down. And we came into this crisis with a slightly extended government balance sheet and fiscal deficit. And also, is India doesn't have a lot of room to maneuver in this. But at the same time, I think the government has been very, very clear that the first priority is to save lives of Indians and no matter what the economic cost. And I think it was a correct decision because eventually, even if you don't, if you had not done what you have done, the economic cost would have been there, but you would have also lost a lot of lives. So I think the Indian government has acted very, very proactively, very fast. Now we have to start, you know, working on the economic impact of this. And one of the economic impact of this, as you correctly said, I think every industry is impacted from housing to steel to cement to automobiles to everything else. It's going to be the financial services industry, the banks, the NBFCs, the mutual funds, all of that. And they are the key intermediaries because I've always said that the financial services industry is like the, you know, the blood in a human body. They have to keep on providing all the liquidity that is there. And what we have seen is this has impacted liquidity in the short term in a fairly big way because everybody's cash flows, an average company that we talk to, their cash flows have come down to 5-10% of normal inflows, but the cash outflows are still about 40-50% of normal because people are still paying salaries and others. So we are seeing that there is a huge liquidity crunch. The banks are doing the best. RBI has been very proactive. They have pumped in a lot of liquidity. But there are challenges on how to convert this liquidity, how to transmit this liquidity from the banking system into the real economy. In fact, this is also one of the key points where Indian financial system will, I think, undergo a change. And firms like CDPQ and foreign investors will play a big role. I think the change will happen that currently the Indian financial system is very banking dependent. All our, when RBI pumps in liquidity, when household savings are generated, they all go into the banking system. And as the banks, I think not only just the NPAs that they've had in the recent past, a lot of banks don't have a long-term, the banks can't invest for 10 years and 20 years because a lot of their customers will want to withdraw money as and when they require. So banks usually all over the world provide capital which is at best about 3 to 5 years, but beyond 5 years we need long-term capital, and it is funds like CDBQ and other long-term pension funds, insurance companies, endowments, and sovereign wealth funds who will provide long-term, patient, flexible capital to India, especially when we have this huge investment need that is ahead of us in infrastructure, in a lot of other industries. And what we've seen is Indian savings via Indian banks, but a lot of foreign capital coming via the funds and pension funds like this is going to be able to meet India's needs. So I think at the end of this, we will see a bifurcation of Indian financial system with banking on one side and capital markets via the funds and all the other side. And even Indian insurance companies, foreign pension funds, all of that will provide the long-term capital. So the banks will provide short to medium-term capital, and the fund and all will provide a medium to long-term capital for the economy. So I think, as you have seen, India always uses crisis to change. And I think the Indian financial system will come out stronger out of this crisis. It will also change and evolve to adapt to this situation.
Thank you, Rashesh. I think your voice was breaking a little bit. Please, if you can rectify that, Shivani. So
yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, now it's much clearer.
Okay.
No, it wasn't you. I think there was some problem, but now when we come back, I think then maybe closer to the mic would help.
Okay.
Okay, Rashesh, thank you. So coming to you, Anita, before I can't see you, Anita, if you can switch on your video, please.
I was conserving bandwidth.
Okay. So Anita, before I ask you, I just want to, you know, just tell you a small incident. So, you know, when I was small, I was in school, I was really bad at maths. I was so bad with numbers. I could write very well. I used to be, you know, get full marks in all my spellings and dictation, but was very bad with sums and any numbers. So my only consolation, everybody would say, look, you can't be good with both numbers and words. So that was my consolation I grew up with until I met you. Because you're a number wizard, of course, which everybody knows. You've grown the numbers tremendously in India, but also you have a way with words, Anita. And that is something that, you know, is remarkable. So with that, you know, I'm sure everybody is waiting to, you know, hear you. And tell us about a little bit about CDPQ in the global context. What do you see the economy today, Indian economy, and where do you see yourself and fellow, you know, investors, fellow organizations like CDPQ?
Thank you very much, Nadira, and thank you for the compliment, though very not so well-deserved compliment. And thank you, Mr. Harish, for pausing your presentation. Hello, Rashesh, always a pleasure to have you as part of the ICBC crowd. I just wanted to apologize to start with. I was actually in a risk committee meeting and I had predicted to Nadira in today's times, the risk committee meetings seemed to go longer and longer. And someone asked me in that meeting, are we going to have a different bar on returns? And I said, actually, it's the risk-adjusted return that's going to affect the bar on returns, not so much just the pure return side, but the risk side. And that's sort of a global theme today and comes from the fact that this crisis is, as Rashesh very eloquently put it, it's really a massive human crisis. At the same time, it has a huge economic cost. And it's not confined to any one country. In fact, it's almost like a domino effect where it's affecting different countries and each of us are going through our peaks and hoping that the flattening of the curve will happen sooner than later. But as we cover different countries globally, I see that, you know, almost every country on the planet is suffering and don't have like an easy time. And that has sort of changed the scenario completely. But before I go to the during COVID, maybe I can just spend 2 minutes on before COVID, which was really a time when pension funds, we opened our office in India 4 years ago, and we have had many of the Canadian pension funds, and I would say also others like the Australian pension funds, and even some of the US pension funds, and Rashesh and Edelweiss have been responsible for bringing some of them also into the country and making investments. And that trend had been well established. And as Mr. Harish said, you know, the number for Canadian investments is in that range, 55 billion. And also, I think more importantly, you're seeing more and more of us establishing a presence on the ground. And that has been phenomenal. We are also called upon by US funds, funds from UK, funds from Sweden, funds from Australia, who have asked us, how is it that you Canadians are investing so much in India? And so I think in the past 4 years, what we have seen is the fundamentals in India. And I won't go into that because everybody here knows that very well, the demographics, the entrepreneurial spirit in India, the digitization, etc. But I think now the question we have to ask ourselves, that in a world where even the developed countries are struggling to find the kind of support they need to give to their populations, I mean, no one would have imagined even 3 months ago that the US would have 20 million unemployed people. And today that's looking like a reality. And so in that scenario, capital is going to get scarce and there is going to be a view where should we put capital. Another thing that has come to the fore to me, especially as we look at international conversations of what will the world look like post-COVID, there is a lot of debate about how quickly an economy can bounce back. And that is being tied really to the kind of support that's coming both from monetary as well as fiscal measures. And we have seen, you know, in the developed countries, whether we are talking about Canada, US, UK, France, Germany, there's about 10% and plus of the GDP being used as fiscal and monetary stimulus into the economies. So one is that from an India point of view, what do we need to do to really make sure that we walk that tightrope of having the funds to deal with COVID itself, which in itself is an expensive crisis from a health and human lives point of view. How do we deal with the livelihood of especially the poorest people in India? And then how do we make sure that this industry and the financial sector actually is functioning? And if we look back at just before COVID, the financial sector was already under a lot of stress. It started with the IL&FS 2018 September crisis, and you know, the NBFCs have been under stress since, as have the banks. And then we had more recently the Yes Bank takeover, and that has also sort of posed the question as to how fragile is the financial system in India. And I think with COVID coming on top of that, the question has only gotten louder in terms of, is this financial system robust? And that's something that where we need to make sure that we do not have any more accidents in the financial sector, because that really would undermine the confidence in the sector. And often we don't realize the importance of the financial sector because it's seen as a separate sector. But actually, if you look at the close link to the real sector, and really the fortunes of the real sector are very intricately tied with the fortunes of the financial sector. So unless we have a strong NBFC banking and capital markets, as Rashish mentioned very rightly, we will not be able to see the uptick in the real sector, which we need to provide the jobs that were already, we had a large number of jobs, and post this crisis, even higher number of jobs. From the point of view of CDPQ, we are a long-term investor. And as you rightly mentioned, our philosophy has always been find the right partners in each of our countries and in each of our sectors, and work with them. And we have demonstrated that. We have financed Edelweiss as recently as last year, when the NBFC crisis was already unfolding. We financed Piramal, which is another NBFC, also more recently, again, in the thick of the NBFC crisis. And we stand ready to finance our partners even as things go forward. But what I think is important for India as a country to continue attracting the kind of capital that we need is really to be very clear in terms of the fact that we will be supporting our financial sector very strongly. We will be supporting the financial sector in a way that actually transmits that financial flow, the credit flow, into the real sector. And I think that is one of the key things that we really have to pursue. I would say that I'm very impressed by the way the government is handling the COVID crisis. And it's very important at the same time that we have a team that's focused on really the future. That's one of the things that we're doing at CDPQ, for example. We have a team that's focused on the here and now, our existing portfolio, our existing partners, and we have a team that's working on what's the world going to look like post-COVID, which are the sectors which will need help, which are the sectors that are growing, and where we can actually see opportunities. And that kind of dual track approach, I think, will be very important for us to come out of this crisis and really bounce back as quickly as possible.
I will give it over to Mr. Harish to, answer a few of the things that you have brought about. And after that, after Mr. Harish speaks, I think we'll take a couple of questions because we've got rapidly questions coming up for all the panelists before we go back to Rashesh and Anita and whoever. And if there are questions addressed to you, please feel free to answer. Mr. Harish, so a couple of things. One is like, as you had started by saying that, you know, the government is working very hard and there is no doubt about it. There is an admiration for the Indian government all over the world as to how you have reacted to the situation and what you have been doing and also the measures that are quickly taken. Just one little concern was that while these measures are all, you know, have been told that, okay, these are what is happening, is there any accountability, any responsibility that, you know, the implementation will happen of these measures? I know that there's nothing that you can say or predict, it is something that will happen. But, you know, is there going to be any kind of responsibility? Second, also, as Anita mentioned, that in this now post-COVID-19 situation, what are the sectors that the government is focusing on? And what are the new opportunities in this, at this time?
Thank you, Nadiraji. I think Anitaji just said, the government, as part of the management of the pandemic and addressing and tackling it, has created 11 empowered groups. These empowered groups have been created cutting across ministries, and they, each of these 11, address specific aspects of it. For example, I am a member of the empowered group number 6, headed by the CEO of Niti Aayog, Shri Amitabh Kant, which deals with NGOs, which deals with the private sector, the chambers and business chambers, and it is also dealing with international organizations. Likewise, there is an empowered group that deals with procurement issues and various aspects regarding the PPEs or the ventilators, hospital and medical equipment. There is a separate empowered group, for example, that deals with aspects of communication and information, how you take the message across. So these empowered groups have been created and they are active. They are engaged with a wide variety of stakeholders. For example, Empowered Group 6 is in touch with about 10,000 NGOs across the country who are registered on the Darpan portal of Niti Aayog, for example. How they can be part and how they can be our partners as we reach out, for example, to the migrants who are stuck in various parts of the country. what is it they can do to help district administrations in various parts of the country in dealing with the pandemic management and how they can contribute. So there are various empowered groups that are actually dealing with this. I think through our line ministries, the DPIIT and Invest India, they have been very, very active in this period in continuing to handhold investors on various issues that they face. For example, in the various state governments. In the last few weeks, Invest India and DPIIT have done an excellent job in reaching out and handholding investors in addressing some of their concerns in the various states and the various issues that are of interest. I think I would talk a little bit about the sectors that you mentioned. I think as far as Canada is concerned, I think we believe that in the post-COVID period, countries around the world will continue to focus on agriculture, food, and nutritional security. I think these are vital for any country. From our point of view, agriculture is a very important sector of the economy and employs over 50% of those who are employed. Likewise, in the case of Canada, agriculture continues to be a very significant economic sector. I believe an important sector from the point of view of the Indo-Canadian Business Chamber would be how we leverage and enhance our economic engagement between our two countries in the field of agriculture. Right now, despite the lockdown, state governments and the government of India are focused on ensuring that the harvesting season proceeds fine and that there is proper storage and other processes in place. And the sowing season is also goes about seamlessly. In terms of Canada, I think we have much we can benefit from cold chain management, from marketing and handling, from storage management and silos. But there is one aspect which I believe is very, very important. Canada has acquired significant capabilities in the field of plant protein and plant protein foods. I think this is something which has huge potential. Moving away from our bilateral engagement on pulses, which can, some years there is a significant trade in pulses and other food grains, in other years it is not. I think it is important that Canada's significant domestic capabilities and the technologies that they have developed for processing of plant protein, ensuring enhanced bioavailability of plant protein, presenting plant protein in more attractive formats for consumers around the world, has a lot of relevance for India. A significant proportion of our population are vegetarians. And as incomes rise, many of them are moving towards other animal protein. But plant protein, if it is packaged in a different format, if it has enhanced bioavailability, and with the technologies that Canadian Centers of Excellence have developed, and I reach out to some of the listeners here from Saskatchewan and Alberta who may have been here and who have visited earlier and I've had these conversations. We believe that investments from Canada in the field of agriculture and in plant protein technologies have huge potential, primarily for us, for our domestic requirements, and also for India as a processing center from here on for export. The second area which I believe will see a significant interest in India and in many countries in the world is the health sector. This includes health infrastructure, it includes equipment, it includes medical supplies, PPEs, masks, sanitizers. It includes pharmaceutical products, and India is a large pharmaceutical producing country, a pharmacy of the world as it goes. And we are focused on generics and making available vital medicines in an equitable and affordable way for a majority of the population of the world, including in many of the least developed countries. I think this will emerge again as a key focus area. as countries after the pandemic are able to address the need to strengthen the healthcare infrastructure, need to strengthen the entire manufacturing value chain required for medical supplies, vital medical supplies, because as we have seen, if this is in demand across geographies, the ability to be able to meet the requirements would get impacted as many countries are vying for the same goods. So I think this will be a focus area in future. As now we focus on testing kits, as we focus on therapeutics, including repurposing existing medicines that we have, and looking for vaccination candidates that will come up. I think we have a great fit in collaborating with our partners in Canada and in other countries so that we are ready to be able to produce both drugs and vaccines that are required in the large dosages that would be required around the world, I think in the short to medium term as we go through this process. I think these are two important sectors, and I believe these are very important sectors for us to be able to attract Canadian investors who have the experience, the technology, and who have been leaders in some of these areas. So agriculture and health sector, including equipment, supplies, and pharmaceuticals, I believe will be important areas for India, for Canada, and for many countries in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harish. So Rashesh, the question from Mr. Rakesh Nangia, whom I think most of you must be knowing, also has a very big financial services company here, and he's with Arthur Anderson. So he had sent his questions in advance. So I'm going to first take his question. For Rashesh, he says, due to massive erosion of wealth due to COVID, what is your suggestion to the investors? Do you have any concern in delinquency taking place of the financial institutions?
Yeah, I think the question he's asking is a very important one. A lot of people are grappling. Honestly, I think everybody's trying to figure out what post-COVID.
Rashesh, if you can just be closer to the mic.
Yeah, so I think everybody's trying to figure out what is going to happen to the world. Is it audible now?
Yes.
Okay. I think everybody's trying to figure out what is going to happen to the world in Indian economy post-COVID. There is a huge economic cost, not just for us. I think everywhere in the world, there has been destruction of wealth. There has been economic damage that has happened. Unfortunately, this is almost like an act of God, and we all have to accept it in that sense. I think that in the short term, there is pain out there. We have already seen that. I think most of the global investors have been exiting emerging markets. To give you an idea, the global investors sold about $20 billion in the 3 months after global financial crisis and in the 3 months after taper tantrum. So the exit from emerging markets was about $20 billion in the 3 months after the crisis earlier. This time, in the last 3 months, global investors have exited $100 billion from emerging markets, out of which about 11-12 is from India. So I think there has already been some amount of damage because there is extreme risk aversion as of now that has already happened, and we are all part of that. I think in the short term, there is pain for India. There will be NPAs. There will be, you know, delinquencies and all. The good news on that is in the last 5-6 years, India has already tackled a fairly high amount of NPAs. The NPAs in the banking system in the last 5 years has been close to $240 billion, which is almost 10% of our GDP at that time. I don't think we will get to that high level. In the last 5 years, we have cleaned up almost about $240 billion. It has been a very painful cleanup, and part of it did impact growth and our economy. But we were getting close to that cleanup when this crisis happened. I don't think this crisis will see that spike of delinquencies which will be equal to 10% of GDP, but it will be painful. I would say short term, there is pain in this, but in the medium term, my optimism comes from the fact that one, India's growth story is still intact. Our demographics, our urbanization, our investment needs, our consumption needs, all of this will continue to drive growth, and COVID is not forever. I mean, we all know that this crisis always passed. It caused a lot of damage in the wake, but after that, it could be a great opportunity for India to reform itself. In fact, if you've seen India's history in the last 30 years, we have always reformed whenever there has been a crisis. The 1919 crisis is the one where all of us grew up. I had just started my career in 1989, and we encountered the 1991 crisis. But I think we all now remember Indian economy as pre-91 and post-91. At that time, it was a balance of payment crisis for India. I think this time is going to be a growth crisis for India, because not just India, all the world, growth is going to take a big beating. And for India, we need the growth. We need to create jobs, we need to industrialize, we need to invest, we need to create infrastructure. And because of that, it will propel the government, it will propel all of us to use this crisis as an inflection point. And I do believe that we will take big reforms in our economic structure. Government has been keen to do that. I think this will give them a room to pass through those reforms, because it's always easier in a crisis to reform yourself. And I think that Indian economic reforms is what makes me very optimistic. I think savings rate will still be around 30%, which is a lot of things. So India's core story, which is based on savings, investment, and consumption, they will continue, maybe not in 2020. But in 2021, it will start again. So I always said that don't bet against India in the long term. In the short term, there is a lot of pain in India, but all investors have exited India, not just India. I think they have exited all emerging markets. But I do believe that these are usually the opportunities to really revisit the industry.
Thank you, Rashesh. Anita, just for you, one question is that will your, by yours, but CDPQ, will the investment strategy remain the same post-COVID in India?
So I think first and foremost, we will focus on our existing partners and our portfolio companies. That's our focus. We have, during this time, as I mentioned, we have done additional investments for those partners, and we are continuing to do some co-investments. Of course, the amounts are small. They are not the big numbers. Like to date, we have $8 billion invested in India within the last 4 years. So that's a big number. I don't see that, kind of big numbers, especially in right now. But I think as a long-term investor, we will definitely continue to invest in India and in emerging markets as a whole. We do see the opportunity and we see the growth that's possible in these countries, medium to long-term.
Thanks, Anita. Let me go to the questions, because we have a lot of the questions. So there's one question from Shaibal Ghosh, who is the Trade Commissioner at the Canadian High Commission, High Commission of Canada and India. So Shaibal says, is there a need to have a total paradigm shift in our approach in all aspects of managing our lives, be it economy, education, international trade, etc.? I think this could be directed to just maybe a line from each of you, and then we'll go on to another question. Anita, let's start with you.
So I think definitely there'll be a paradigm shift in terms of the way we live, and I think it's going to affect all parts of our behavior. Globally, on the trade side, already we had seen with the US-China issues that there was already a shift in terms of people looking at whether the global trade system will continue to work as it had in the past. So I think that trend will get accelerated. And I feel that India stands to benefit from that. And that's something that if we can play our cards right, we can really benefit from. However, I see a lot of changes in other areas as well. We are seeing it in already during this period in the field of healthcare, education, e-commerce, and those trends they are here to stay, I think, and they'll get even more further accelerated.
So, yeah, anything that you want to add, Mr. Harish or Rashesh, or should I go on to the next question?
The only thing I would add is that a black swan event like the pandemic of this nature only proves the importance of focusing on risk. Countries focusing on risk, business actors focusing on risk, and individuals focusing on risk in their day-to-day lives. And how do we build redundancies and resilience in institutions, in countries, in individual households to deal with risk? If you're going to, spend, or if you're going to buy as if there is no tomorrow, whether it is for a country, a business organization, or a household, I think they need to get back and put the focus back on risk. I think it's a good point. It's a good reminder for every institution, whether it's a household, a business organization, or nations, to look at risk as an important aspect and build redundancies and resilience in their institutions and in their households in being able to deal with it. And that will, of course, include what Mr. Shah focused on. How do you focus on savings? What do you look at consumption? And where does investment come in? And is there a correct balance between all of this, whether it is countries, business organizations, or households? Thank you.
And I would just add that, you know, I think India, if you look at human history, there have been a lot of shocks that we have all experienced for the last thousands of years, and humans have always evolved. So I think this is going to be one of those events which we will allow us to evolve. I think fundamentally, we will not change significantly as this crisis abates, but there'll be tweaks here and there that will happen. I think some of the good things I hope will happen is that one is, this has been a very strong reminder to us on not taking things for granted, the environment for granted, all the things we have. And at least for all of us, you know, the last few weeks have been a big reminder about how little we need, how few things we can make do with, including, I know a lot of us have given ourselves haircuts also, so maybe we don't need barbers and haircutting saloons also. But it's actually, it's amazing how we can make do with so little. So this is also a good reminder that this, you know, constant consumption and me, my, more kind of a culture will get tempered a little bit. I think human beings will become softer because all of us have realized that this hardship is equal, rich, poor, any country, any individual, it's been the same, any, you know, impact on everybody. So I think it will make humanity softer, more conscious, more considerate. But at the end of the day, we are human beings. I think a year down the line, there will be, as they say, you know, the more things change, the more they remain the same. Or as they say in Canada, la plus de chance, la même. So I think yeah, it will be a little bit of that.
So yeah, Rashesh, you're showing how good your partnership is with CDPQ. You've even picked in the course of your last few years.
Much better than mine.
Yeah, so that goes to show. Okay, Anita, I think this, you may not want to contribute to this part of, you know, but there are a few questions. And I know that China is also a very good partner for CDPQ. But I will put it to Mr. Harish and Rashesh that there's a lot of, there are a couple of questions from our people on the Chinese economy. And how do you think that does India stand to benefit from, you know, what they feel is, definitely a fallout for China. So they said the Indian post economy will be closely tied to the Chinese economy post-COVID. Given that, what do the panelists think will happen to the Chinese economy and how will the world's economic relationship with China change? This is from Sabri Ganpati Subramani and from Akhil Fauzi. both have asked in some capacity about India-China. So, Mr. Harish, would you like to just say a couple of words, and Rashesh?
I think China is an important economic actor, and it's an important trade partner for many countries, including India, for Canada, and of course, many other countries in the world. COVID-19 has had its impact on the Chinese economy. It has an impact on most global economies. It has an impact on the Indian economy. So I think our focus currently is how do we deal with the pandemic? How do we move out of the lockdown situation to get to restarting the economy? And how do we continue to position India as a place to where you can easily do business, as a preferred investment destination for any company that seeks to diversify their value chain, de-risk their manufacturing value chain, and how do you make India an important investment destination in such scenarios? I think we need to be focused on this. And of course, the global economic situation, the growth, there are enough estimates from IMF that global growth would be highly subdued. So this is a challenging environment. So without linking it to one economy or another, look at the global economy as saying that, yes, these are headwinds. All economies are impacted by this. And certainly countries who have had to face the pandemic in previous form are impacted by this. So our economy is to continue, our focus is to continue to pitch and position ourselves as a place which is easier to do business and which will continue to attract investments from all companies that want to de-risk their value chains, that want to diversify their value chains. And I think we have the human resources, we have the talent, we have the infrastructure increasingly, and we have the commitment of both the government of India and the various state governments to facilitate and handhold investors in this exercise.
Okay.
I think India and China will always be complementary and competition to each other. But after this experience, a lot of the global manufacturers will make sure they have a foot in India and in China. And I do see that a lot of the Chinese companies will come and invest in FDI in India and have a manufacturing base in India, because I think India-China as part of the supply chain will become a very important link rather than only China or only India. So I think a lot of the global manufacturing will hedge their bets between India and China. We both have our own skills and our own advantages. And obviously, India will have to make it a lot easier. We have always spoken about how to make India more attractive for global manufacturing companies in India. But I do think there will be a lot more collaboration between Indian companies and Chinese companies. And a lot of Chinese companies themselves will want to invest in India, not only to access the Indian market, but also use the Indian platform to cater to global customers who will also want to diversify the risk between India and China.
So just one question. This is to Rashesh Shah. Work from home has become a new normal. What do you think future of the real estate funds and companies like Blackstone? What opportunity and growth do you see for life insurance?
So I think work from home will become a concept, but I don't think it's going to replace offices completely. In fact, I think in Edelweiss, one of the ideas we are toying around post-COVID is to have every Friday as work from home. So you work from office for 4 days, and on Friday, everybody works from home. And then you have the weekend so that, you know, you save on commute and environment and all the other hassle and all that. So I think people will experiment with that. You will not give away the office space completely. So I don't think that we are going to become completely, without offices. Of course, people will try to optimize hot desking and try to curtail real estate cost. But I don't think this will be such a significant change that half the office space will become redundant. I think it's unlikely, because there is growth happening. There is a need that is already there. People will optimize. But I think this combination of few days of work from office, few days of work from home, and a weekend will become maybe the new normal for all of us all over the world. We have already seen that in a lot of companies globally also. I think work from home and flexi hours and all were becoming the norm. And I do think that that will be good to have. So we are also currently thinking about having a day a week as a work from home day. And but I don't think on a long-term basis it will impact the demand for real estate so much. In fact, I think as India grows, the demand for real estate will only go up. In terms of the opportunity for insurance, I think this will be a great opportunity for insurance industry because, as I said earlier, India's needs are going to be long-term money. And whatever household savings go into banks usually come in the short to the medium end, but not to the long end. And as interest rates come down, there is going to be a hunger for yield. In fact, I do believe that, as Anita said, a lot of people will look at risk very closely, and a lot of global investors will see the risk in the short term. I do believe that there is going to be a lot of liquidity because all governments and central banks around the world are going to pump in a massive amount of liquidity to counter the recession which is looming. As a result of that, capital will become cheap and capital will look for yield. And a lot of that capital will find its way into India because if India growth story is there, if India investment needs are there, India will provide good returns to investors. We obviously have to do a lot of changes. We have to reform. We have to make India more investment friendly, business friendly, all of those things, which I think can also happen. But India will be an attractive destination. And the same thing I see that as interest rates are coming down in banks, we have seen the bank deposit rates coming down. More and more households will look for higher yield and be willing to invest for longer term for that. And for that, the insurance industry will be a big conduit. If you see household savings, it gets channelized in three ways: through banks, through mutual funds, and through insurance companies. These are the three main vehicles of channelizing household savings into investments. Insurance is only one where household savings can get really converted into long-term, high-yielding investments. And I do think insurance and pension, and that is what globally also has been there. We don't have a lot of pension funds in India, Indian pension funds, and hence Indian insurance companies will be the main conduit for that.
Yeah, thanks, Rashesh. So as we end this today's session, so just a couple of things that, I think there is, just for Mr. Hari, just your closing remarks, because, that what other countries have put the GDP towards the economic crisis has been 10 to 13%, and India has, almost 0.8 to 1%. So is there going to be some more, are we thinking of some more series of financial, packages that the government is going to release, or is it that we are not going to breach the fiscal deficit? Is there anything that the government is planning as from your perspective totally? I mean, I'm not going to ask very big questions, but just what do you think that the government is planning at this time? And after that, I think I'll just ask Rashesh to say a couple of lines on what Edelgiv is giving. And then Anita, if you could kindly just come in and give some closing remarks. So, Mr. Hari.
I think the finance ministry has already announced that there will be a series of interventions as we go through the management of the pandemic and thereafter. Once we move out of the lockdown and get into restart and kickstart the economy. So they said they would be calibrating and they will be looking at various economic interventions in the period ahead. I think we should wait for that. The RBI has already announced a series of measures to enhance liquidity and to help specific sectors deal with this. So I think there will be government interventions on this count. And I think as we go ahead, the focus, as I said, as the Prime Minister put it, is not only now on saving lives, which will continue to be there, but also on saving livelihoods. And I think this will continue to be an important focus. Undertaking necessary economic reforms, as Mr. Shah pointed out, I think this will be important. The government will continue to be engaged with the business and industry in India, with the various chambers, and will take all ideas on board on how to make India a better investment destination. I think in the period ahead, we need all of us to work with a unity of purpose. On one hand, to deal with the pandemic, on the other hand, to get back, to kickstart the economy so that the economic engine starts and moves ahead. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Harish. That's true. And as you said, we have Saskatchewan with our government with us, the representatives, and they'll be very happy to hear what you've said about agriculture and the future opportunities in agriculture, you know, for trade between India and Canada. And also, so...
Required for sustainability, and I want to say this, if we have so many Indians moving out of poverty and moving, improving their income levels over a period of time, ensuring that they have access to affordable protein and that is produced in a sustainable manner with keeping in view impact on climate change and keeping in view impact on overall sustainability is important. And I think Canadian companies with their technology, with their centers of excellence focused on plant protein, I think would be very, very important partners in this exercise. And I would also urge both pension funds and even Indian companies in the agri sector to actively seek out and to partner with Canadian companies in this regard. This is, in my view, a huge opportunity. The Prime Minister is committed to doubling our farmers' incomes by the year 2022. A lot of this focus in the period ahead will also be on agriculture and how we can ensure this doubling of farmers' incomes. Technology and having the experience of our Canadian partners in this is vital. And I hope we reach out to them and they reach out to us and we are able to make these partnerships work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harish. I should also mention that we have a representative from Ontario government as well. I think Kapil Malhotra is also here. And also Invest Canada is has joined us. So thank you everybody from Canada for joining us. Rashesh, just a couple of lines on Edel Gift because I think you all are doing a fabulous job. So just quickly, and then I'll ask Anita to give the closing remarks.
Yeah, Edel Gift is our foundation, which has started about 12 years ago. And our idea has been that we give part of our profits, but we also use Edel Gift as a channelizing agency. And we get a lot of partners, including organizations like CDPQ, who have contributed and co-invested with us when we invest into a lot of NGOs and all. We support quite a few NGOs. And when this crisis broke out, we immediately raised some money for a lot of NGOs because, you know, one of the problems that is going to be there is a lot of NGOs, the funding for them will dry up as the corporate profitability comes down, as there is a profit crunch and a cash crunch. For a lot of NGOs, even for them to survive and continue to work would be a problem. So we have immediately put together a problem. We are channelizing about 10 crores in this quarter, helping a lot of NGOs, one, to just pay the salaries of the field force and all that to make sure that they don't have to cut headcount and lay off people because their own inflows are going to dry up in the near future. The other one, obviously, like everybody else, we have been very conscious of the issue of the migrant workers, and we have a few NGOs which work with migrant workers very closely, and we have made sure that whatever resources can be channelized for alleviating their problems from food to their transport and all that. There are a lot of very good NGOs working in that. We have also raised money from our employees and from a lot of our partners like CDPQ and a lot of funds who invest with us, who are investors in Edelweiss. And, somebody given $100,000, somebody given $20,000. And all that money has gone into program because one of the good things we have seen is a lot of people from all over the world have been saying, can we do something to alleviate the pain in India? And Edel Gift has said, can we be a catalyst for that? Can we be a channelizing agency? And since we are channelizing our own funds, we can get a lot of people to co-invest with that. So we do look for those opportunities. We have had a lot of our employees also contributing, including a very, people who earn very little. They also have come forward and given 1,000 rupees and 5,000 rupees. Because I think, as I said, this crisis has made us as human beings also slightly more conscious and softer. And most of us are aware of the hardship that a lot of other people are going through. We all are conscious of our own hardship, but I think there are a lot of others who are going through a lot of hardship. I think 2020 is going to be a difficult year. There is going to be a lot of pain ahead of us. And if we can all collectively help each other and keep the morale up, then we'll get to 2021. 2021 will come for sure. COVID will get over for sure. We need to get through this with as much of our emotional and social capital intact as we get through this. And I think through Edelgive and all, we want to make sure that we are also conscious of that.
Thank you, Rashesh. Anita, just a couple of lines as closing remarks.
Thank you, Andhra. I think what Rashesh has just touched on is something that CDQ really values in our partners, because we see that they are contributing not just economically but also socially to the communities that we are part of. I would like to touch on also the comments made by Mr. Harish. I fully agree with you. I think Canada and India can really work closely in the two areas that you mentioned and more. I see a lot of synergies just sitting sort of in a Canadian institution, but being based in India, looking globally. I also see that these areas are ones where both Canada and India can work very closely. There is the whole protein cluster in Canada, where they have done very innovative things, and also bringing together technology and agriculture has been phenomenal. And I think we in India can benefit a lot, and vice versa, because India is such a large market with a lot of entrepreneurial spirit here, that Canadian firms can also benefit a lot from coming into India. So that's something with the ICBC, I think we'll continue to work. I just want to thank everybody in the audience. This crisis, I think, as Rashesh very aptly put it, has taught us really to go beyond our here and now and the narrow focus on just what we represent and stand up more as a community globally. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Anita. Thank you, Mr. Harish. And thank you, Rashesh, for all your inputs. Thank you to both our Indian audience, our Canadian audience, for joining us today. Everybody stay home, stay safe. And we look forward to your joining us again next week for our next webinar. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.